patriotic, to be outspoken.
We are millions strong, and we want another world.
Don't give up.
It's exciting to write books that I want to see in the world.
This has been the most rigorous medication rollout this world has ever seen.
Good, not prison.
Get out.
Good evening. I'm already seeing all these people saying they're excited, and I am too. My name is Maria Blanco. I'm a member of the California Endowment Board of Directors, and I'm honored to serve as the moderator tonight for the conversation we will be having with Cristela Alonso. And I'm not just honored, I feel like I won the lottery, the loteria, when I got this opportunity. I love Cristela's work. I can tell that you do too. She is laugh out loud funny, and captures the real life experiences of immigrant families, but particularly Latino Mexican American families, with so much humor, but also with incredible insight. So everybody that's tuning in, this is being recorded. There'll be a link. You'll be able to look at it later. I want you to know that we have two sign interpreters and a Spanish interpreter. Our Spanish interpreters, Frida Bloom and Andrea Lust, will be providing sign language. So, Frida, I think you're going to do one instruction for us as an interpreter, correct?
Correct. Thank you, Maria. In order to provide language access, this meeting will have simultaneous bidirectional interpretation into Spanish as well as American Sign Language. My name is Frida Bloom, and I'll provide the interpretation in Spanish. And my colleague, Andrea Lust, who you see next to me, will be providing interpretation in American Sign Language. If you wish to continue to see Andrea after this demonstration, at this moment, please click on the interpretation button below and select American Sign Language. And now I'll explain how to enable the feature in Spanish. Si necesita interpretación en español y está usando su computadora de escritorio o portátil, en unos segundos verá un icono en forma de globo en la parte inferior de su pantalla. Haga clic en interpretación y después seleccione español o Spanish. Si está usando su iPad o su teléfono, en unos segundos busque el menú de tres puntos o que dice More en una de las esquinas de su pantalla. Haga clic en interpretación y después seleccione español o Spanish y después aceptar, finalizar o Done. Gracias. Thank you.
Thank you, Frida. All right, let's get going. I know you're really excited to hear from our featured guest tonight, so let's bring her in. And I'm honored to introduce to you Cristela Alonso.
Hello. Hi, Maria.
Hi. Okay. So I'm going to, you know, I want to make sure that I get out some information, which is important about your tour, because I know you're touring right now, and right now you're in D.C., so can you, before we get into the conversation, can you just tell us what you're working on? Where are you going? What was your last show? And when are you coming back home to Cali?
My last show was actually Las Vegas this weekend. I was doing a show as part of Mexican Independence Day weekend in Las Vegas.
Oh,
and,
cool.
You know, I took my family to Vegas years ago, a couple years ago, to see Luis Miguel. And, you know, for the Independence Day, he has a mariachi, everything. And,
yeah.
You know, it was one of those things where I don't really, Las Vegas doesn't appeal to me in the whole party scene of it all. But one thing that it does right is that it does such a good job of absorbing the weekend, the culture, the moment that it has at hand, that it was so great to be part mm-hmm. of the Mexican Independence Weekend. And I performed at the Westgate Casino, which is actually, I played in Elvis Presley's old theater.
Oh.
So it was really great because, you know, that's one thing, the Westgate is such an, it's an older property that is full of history. And I love history. I am a fan of it. I love learning about it. So I just played Vegas. I'm actually working on my third hour that I'll probably shoot at the top of 2025. And, you know, the first special I had was called Lower Classy, and the second one was called Middle Classy. So the third one is going to be called Top Gun 2. So, you know,
I know I had some other things I wanted to ask you, but I actually had a question about that.
Yeah.
Because I've watched them, you know, and I think I understand the progression that's taking place. Mm-hmm. And so it's kind of personal.
Yes.
You know, like, you know, like when you get to middle class, now you have a doctor.
Yes. Know? Yes.
I'm curious, like, what made you want to do that in that format? And where, what are you going to be upper classy?
Well, you know, I mean, Mercedes? The third hour is upper classy, you know? And, you know, it's actually, it's something that I didn't, what I've learned when I started doing stand up. And I think that a lot of us, when we're younger, we try to plan out our lives and we try to set these goals for ourselves. And when I started out doing stand-up, I kept telling myself, well, I want to do this and I want to do that. But really, I just wanted to do stand-up. And one thing that I've learned is that by doing stand-up, I have been afforded the opportunities to do other things.
Right.
And by other things, it's not even the stereotypical Hollywood life or anything, because I don't have that. To me, what I've learned in my progression in these specials is that the more I ascend into a different economic level, the more I'm able to actually take care of myself and my loved ones. And that is something that I think so many of us can connect with. But we don't have enough people talking about it so openly, because really, you know, it's one of those things that, to me, growing up in poverty, in extreme poverty, now I have a history, I have a past that I can talk about that maybe is unknown to a lot of people. I always say that the problem with so many of us is that sometimes we don't think our stories are special.
Yeah.
Sometimes we think, well, you know, who am I? You know, so many people say, well, who am I? What do I do? And I do that too, you know, but when I was younger, in the neighborhood that I grew up in, everybody had very similar backgrounds.
Right.
And because of that, you don't think your story is special.
Right.
Then I was fortunate enough to start traveling. I started doing theater in high school, which we'll get to, you know, it's like I started doing theater and I started going to nationals and, you know, I started traveling and seeing other cities. And what I realized was that people treated me differently.
Yeah.
Because I stood out. I didn't stand out at home, but I stood out everywhere else.
Mm-hmm.
And I realized that what I was taking for granted by just thinking, oh, well, everybody lives like this. Not true. It's actually what set me apart. And I do believe that a lot of my career has been because I'm so open about talking about where I come from that people find it really interesting, almost hard to believe at times.
Yeah, I love that what you started out saying that that now you can take care of yourself and other people. But not just that you just said that now, but that you're so open about that in this series, right? In the Netflix series,
mm-hmm.
because I think, well, this leads me to a whole other set of questions I have for you, which is really like, so I think if you're come from a poor family, you come from a Mexican-American family, not just, but poor, some of the things you talk about with insurance and when you talk about yes. therapy,
yes.
But I'm wondering, what do you think that people who come see you who are always were middle class or white, why is it funny to them?
You know, I think that what I have learned is one of the skills that I have, which I didn't think was a skill, was that I'm very good at being specific. And it actually reminds people, I think that being a Latina and being the daughter, like coming from an immigrant family, I think that very early on in my career, I realized that I was there to help dispel the stereotypes and assumptions that were made for my community, because I always tell people, in theory, I am the problem. You know, it's like, I'm a first generation Mexican American, Spanish is my first language. I grew up in a mixed status family. You know, it's what you hear, the rhetoric is what I am. And aside from that, though, because I am what I am, my mom taught me to love this country. And my mom taught me to be proud of who I was. And my goal is to let everybody know that we're a lot more connected than we are separate. And I think a lot of us talk about that, and a lot of us will say that, but I think that having the job where I travel and go on the road, it's been so interesting to talk to people. And that's kind of how I see my shows. I think that the audience reaction is their part of the conversation.
Yeah, you know, it's almost like you're doing, you're almost educating people.
Yes, I do it intentional.
It's clear that it's intentional.
Yes.
But it's, what I love, of course, about humor is that you can do that in a funny way, but you're really, once they're in love with you, because they fall in love with you because you're just great, you're funny, you know, but now you're telling them some real hard truths, but now they are drawn to
it in. Right? You sneak it in. You know, that's one thing that I think that a lot of us could do that better, in trying to convey a message that we can, that we want. And I just mean different communities, different, you know, advocacy, everything that you want to be, you know, to do. It's like, one thing that a lot of people do is they speak facts, they speak statistics. And sometimes people can get turned off because people learn differently. And I think that a lot of times, if this makes sense, I think that my style of stand-up is actually, I teach people things that might be very hard and awkward to hear, but at the end of the day, they know that A, I'm okay. B, I'm so open to talk about this that it has to matter somehow. But also that you can talk about it and you can do it in a way where you're informing people by sneakily educating them through laughter.
Yeah.
At the end of the day, they can leave my show and think, wow, I never thought about it that way.
Right. Right.
That's part of the appeal.
Yeah. Yeah. It's wonderful. I have one thing I need to tell you, because I love how much you cuss. You know, and I'll tell you, no, I do, because all the women in my family, and I, you know, all tias, sisters, cousins, we all cuss like crazy.
Yes.
And the men don't. It's the women.
That's so true. My brothers don't. I do. I cuss for them. Like, you know,
it's just like, so when I'm listening to it, I'm thinking, oh, maybe it's not just me.
Well, you know, I also think that the way that I grew up, it's like, I cuss because I'm tired. You're just tired. You know what I mean? You're like, look.
Do I have to explain this, or can I just say?
Yes. Can we just cut through all of it and just get down to it? You know, it's like, I also say that sometimes, you know, it's like, you have to really pick and choose when you want to cuss, because it really expresses or explains an idea. It conveys it a little bit stronger. You know, sometimes it really just hits a little different.
Yeah. But I just had to share that, because I was like, you know, that's the women in my family. What can I say? So you are completely bilingual.
Yes.
And I grew up in Spanish too. So we both speak English. People are always surprised, but we do. And I know you've talked about this in some of your shows, but can you tell us a little bit? Are you the youngest in your family?
Yes, I'm the youngest of four kids. And, and by the way, I'm the youngest by like 11 years from the next sibling, my sister.
Okay. Yeah. My brother, who's the oldest, is 9 years older. So I know you talked a lot about learning English through TV.
Mm-hmm.
But without going into all of it, was that intentional? Like, did you say, okay, I'm going to sit down, I'm going to learn this? And I'm
no.
Was it just, how did that happen?
You know, my mom couldn't speak English. So right. We had a rule in our house that we had to speak Spanish in front of her. We could never speak English around her.
Yeah, us too.
She had a rule that she's like, I want to understand everything that you say. You're not allowed to speak English.
We were scolded if we spoke in English.
Absolutely. My mom too. Same way, you know? And it was this thing where I'm a Gen Xer, you know, and I was a latchkey kid from an early age. So I kind of took care of myself and I would watch these shows, you know? And look, in my family, we had two TVs. One TV was for the boys and one TV was for the girls.
Oh, wow.
My mom and I would share the TV. And my mom, because she only spoke Spanish, we would watch like Telemundo,
Univision. Was it in the kitchen?
No, it was actually, you know, my mom and I shared a twin bed in a little room till I was 18 years old. And that was in our room. And we would, you know, and my mom was a cook at a Mexican restaurant and she would come home from the restaurant. And I was allowed to see TV that I wanted when she wasn't there. But the moment she showed up, it was time to watch the TV, you know, like whatever she wanted. At night, we'd watch the novelas, we'd watch everything, like it was her TV. So then when I started watching shows, I was really in love. You know what it was? Some of the shows like Knight Rider.
Oh.
I thought Knight Rider was a Mexican show because I used to watch it dubbed in Spanish when I would like stay with my grandma. So then when I saw it in English, I'm like, wow, they translated it in English. You know, and I was like, I kind of started learning English because of that, you know, and then I don't know what it is, but like, you know, it's the stereotypical kind of like kid childhood that sometimes you would stay home sick from school or something. Yeah. You'd end up watching the game shows, the soap operas with like your mom and stuff. And I was obsessed with The Price is Right because it was just colors and sounds and everything. It's like the circus every day for kids, The Price is Right. You know, and Plinko was my favorite game. Right now, my goal in life, in real life, is to play Plinko before I die. That is one of my life goals, to play Plinko, because I love it so much. But you know, it's like, I would watch it and I'm like, man, this is such a cool show. But then I would watch it by myself. So I would learn the TV, like the English from TV.
Yeah.
In my family, I don't have an accent compared to my siblings. Because
right.
I was mimicking what I learned. That's a thing that people don't understand. A lot of us that were Spanish speakers, you know, first, we imitate. We're imitating what we're seeing. So, which actually ended up being a gift in theater because I learned English by imitating voices. So when I got into theater, I started imitating how I learned how to do English. So, you know, it's like.
So you took that skill and you used it for theater.
Yes. And honestly, you know, Maria, it was so interesting because I didn't know that that was a skill. It was just how I understood. Here's my surprise birthday party that I just threw. Surprise! It's my quinceañera. It's my 45-niera. You're all invited. I learned how to do little characters. Where even now, when I watch commercials and I hear a character, like I hear a voice that sounds interesting, I will imitate the voice.
Oh, that's so interesting. Yeah.
Just because it's that's how I learned. But yeah, you know, it's like, so I learned it in English and I learned it by myself. So like I would watch The Price is Right and I'm like, oh, Plinko, like Plinko is English. Like, what does Plinko mean? Like, I feel Plinko today. Like, you know what I mean? And you know, cause nobody would correct me, you know?
Right.
Here's the thing though.
How did you get into theater?
I got into theater by force. They made me go into theater. It was actually in eighth grade, my junior high, you had to have a fine arts credit to go to high school. Mm-hmm. And in eighth grade, I signed up for theater. I signed up for an acting class. And the first day of class, this teacher, Mr. Honnell, who I'm still friends with, you know, he had this exercise. And he was like, okay, we're going to act. Everybody, I want you to pick a household appliance. And you're going to act it out. Be the appliance. And I just stood there and did nothing. And he came up to me and he's like, you're not doing it. And I'm like, I am. I'm a vacuum cleaner and I'm broken. You know? Literally, like eighth grade, like I left, I went to class. My best friend and I had the same lunch. The next day I get called into the office and the principal tells me that they changed my schedule. And I'm so upset because now my best friend and I have different lunches. And he says, the drama teacher changed your schedule. So now you're in competitive theater. And I got so upset. I went straight to the teacher and I said, hey, I want to have lunch with Yvonne. And now I can't because you put me in this class. And by the way, I can't compete. My mom won't let me stay after school. My mom would not, like, she couldn't. My mom couldn't understand the concept of school, like extracurricular activities and stuff, even though I was the youngest of four kids. She couldn't understand it, you know? And it was this thing where like my teacher said, no, you need to be in this class.
Was this a school that was primarily Mexican American or no?
Oh, yes. Look, let me tell you, Maria.
The teacher was white though, right?
Yes, there was a time where they would actually, they would hire teachers from like Minnesota and bring them down because they needed teachers. So like he was like this white teacher from Minnesota. Everybody was Mexican. Like it was so Mexican that we all knew the one white woman, the one white student that was in class. Like, you know what I mean? It was that Mexican. Yeah. Let me tell you, it was so Mexican. My school district is so Mexican that my freshman year of high school, we did a Mexican production of The Diary of Anne Frank.
In Spanish?
No, but the teacher wanted to add mariachi. He wanted I'm like, do you know?
He wanted to put it in the Mexican context?
We're supposed to be quiet. No, we're doing the Holocaust. We're doing actual Diary of Anne Frank. A group of Mexican kids are doing The Diary of Anne Frank. And like,
that's fantastic.
And that's the thing. Because I went to an all Mexican high school, we weren't told that we couldn't do anything.
They didn't give us the kids because you were all Mexican.
They didn't give us limits. So like during high school, they taught us, my junior high teacher, my high school teachers, they taught me Miss Saigon. They taught me they would break down musicals. We would reenact musicals. We did Les Mis at the end of the day. And it's just all these Mexican kids doing these musicals. And it was just what we did. And I was so good at theater that I was like, this is what I want to do.
I'm surprised that you had theater because, you know, so many schools now don't have any arts programs or theater. You know, any of that.
Actually were very lucky because my school district, we had two high schools when I was in high school. The other high school that I didn't go to, the drama teacher was, I want to say, like the ambassador of the arts for the state of Texas. In fact, the border town that I grew up in, that area, the Rio Grande Valley, when I was in school, theater was as big as football.
Really?
Yes, because it was just huge. We were like a theater, gang. Like we dominated everything. Like we were just, you know, it was just, it was so interesting. My school district started these things called children's shows. So what they would do every year, the theater kids, we would put on a children's play and we would bus in elementary school, like from first to sixth grade, we'd bus them and we'd perform the plays during school to get them into theater at an early age. And it was like the thing that you did. And, you know, it's like, that's how I got into doing the children's show, because I remember doing them as a kid, you uh-huh. know, and it was this uh-huh. thing where by showing and exposing the kids to something, you know, it made it such a natural part of life to be into the theater. It wasn't until I graduated high school and I tried to go to college, I ended up dropping out, but like a voice teacher when I was 18, a white voice teacher when I was 18, said, well, you know, as a Latina, you can do West Side Story and you can do Chorus Line.
Oh my God.
And then you're done. And it broke my heart because I'm thinking, well, in high school, I did The Diary of Anne Frank. We were in, we did production of Into the Woods. We did, you know, like it was just anything and everything. It wasn't until I left my home that they told me that I wasn't an actor. I was a Mexican actor. I wasn't just an actor. I was a Latina actor. And that's when I realized that other people were trying to limit what I could do.
Yeah.
And that's why I started doing stand-up. Because I told
myself, like the niche you found for yourself?
Yeah. I told myself if I was ever going to do what I wanted to do, which was to perform and like be in front of a crowd and do theater, I was going to have to write it myself because no one was going to write it for me. Because right. that's the thing, right? The perception is that I've always said this with Latino actors. We were around during Aztec Mayan times. Then we died. We're not around for Shakespeare. No Latinos knew Shakespeare. No one knew, like nothing. And then in the 70s, we came back to sell drugs, you know? And then Latina actresses, you're in your 20s, you're the sex pot.
Yeah.
You're kind of the sex pot. 40s and 50s, get out of my face, come back when you're the abuela.
Yeah.
You know, and that was it. And it, to me, it was just like, nope, not going to do it because Maria, I'm a nerd.
You always liked the stage though.
I loved the stage. You know what, you know why it was? My mom was very uneducated. She used to say that herself. She only went up to second grade. She didn't go to school, you know, and she would always say like, when I would get my report cards, I would sign her name because she was embarrassed of her handwriting because she couldn't really read or write very well. And my mom, people used to always make fun of me. They still do. It's this age old question, right? Like when they say that, when I tell them that I speak Spanish, there's always gonna be people that say, you don't speak Spanish good enough. Like, oh, look at you. You barely speak Spanish. And I always say, well, you should talk to my mom because she understood everything I said. You know what I mean? But it's this thing that people don't understand. I learned English from her. And her Spanish wasn't the quote unquote correct Spanish too. It was the vernacular, like from what she learned in her village, the rancho and stuff, you know? But it was this thing where, you know, you're just like, with my mom, when we would spend days together because we shared the same bed, she became my friend. She wasn't only my mom, she was my friend. And she was undocumented for years.
Yeah.
And there's something that we don't talk about, which is the stress
that
the family feels when someone is undocumented, if they themselves are undocumented, or they know someone that they love that's undocumented.
I know.
It's this thing where
I know
in the area that I grew up, you grew up living amongst border patrol agents.
Yeah.
You know, people always talk about immigration and the problem of the border and everything. Like I'm like, it's been going on forever. It's not anything more than it has always been. I grew up with sweeps from like border patrol and everything. It's always existed, you know? Yeah. And when you live like that, there's always a stress. I felt myself getting very parentified like from an early age because I had to protect my mom from the border patrol.
Were you the only one of the kids that was documented?
No, actually, you know, there's four of us. The oldest one was born and raised in Mexico. the other brother and the sister, my sister, they were born here, but my mom took them back to Mexico. So they were born here and they went back and lived there for like 12, 15 years before they came here. Yeah. So, and they were all, you know, delivered by midwives.
So common at the border, so common.
You know, so it is this thing where with my mom, I really learned how to perform because of her. Mm. Because she was a friend and I wanted to protect her.
Yeah.
I would see days where she was scared, where she was angry, where she was sad. And I tell this story, you know, like we used to watch back in the day before streamers and everything existed, people would pick a network and watch it every day. You know, like we would watch The Bold and the Beautiful. And The Bold and the Beautiful had this character named Ridge. And Ridge back then had a cleft in his chin and he had sideburns. And the soap opera was only 30 minutes long. And sometimes when I would see her getting down on herself, I would get her red Maybelline eyeliner pencil. And I would paint the sideburns on my face. Aww. And do the cleft. And I would translate the episode of the day from English to Spanish and do little characters for her to cheer her up.
Aww.
And that was how I learned how to perform. But here's the thing though, I didn't know that was a job. My family's all physical labor, manual labor. Like, you know, it's like, we're not taught that jobs, you can have a job where you can think. You're never taught that you have a job where you can write your thoughts. Like that is a luxury. That is a luxury we don't talk about.
Work is manual work and yeah.
Yeah. And
sitcom, is the mother a lot like your mother or is completely different?
Oh, the mother is a lot like my mother. The mother, and that was a thing, you know, it's funny. When I had my show, I think that I gave the audience a lot more credit than what I ended up getting. Mm-hmm. In that I didn't realize that so many Latinos would be so critical of the show because it didn't represent their lives. Mm-hmm. You know, and because it wasn't their family, I wasn't telling an accurate picture of my family. You know, there was but I understand it at the same time because we get such little opportunities that when we get the opportunities on air, we want them to be perfect.
Yes,
we don't want that. I don't judge them for that, but I understand it. You know.
You were the first show, so
yes,
the expectation of the first sitcom.
Absolutely.
You were supposed to do everything.
You know, and I think that with the show premise, you know, it was my mom, I'm living with my sister, helping her raise her kids, which I did do that. That was actually all true. You know, it's like my mom moved in. I was taking care of my mom until she passed away. I was my mom's caregiver, but I was also my sister's caregiver right before I started doing stand-up. And, you know, it was this thing where the show was that my sister in the show was my older sister, like in real life. My mom was very like from Mexico, very, you know, what she was in the show is how she was. And I remember we did a screening in Miami because the network sent me everywhere that they thought Latinos lived to screen this show. They wanted us to get permission from the community to like, hey, do you like this? Tell everybody about it, right? We did a screening in Miami. And a woman afterwards said, raised her hand and said, why does the mom have to be so stereotypical? My mom's not like that. And I told her, I asked her, well, which mom are you talking about?
Yeah. Right.
My mom, like my mom or my sister? Because my sister in the show is a mom too. So what I'm showing is the evolution between generations because my mom came from Mexico. My sister was born here. And you're going to see an evolution in how they parent. So, but I'm like, but I understand what you mean. I'm like, I want to point out that you actually missed that there's another
mother. There's another mother there.
Exactly. You know, because you see what you want to see.
Yeah. Yeah. Did your family react okay to you portraying them? Did they feel good about it? Did they feel misrepresented?
No, my family doesn't understand what I do. You know, like, it's like this thing. I remember there was a show in Dallas that I did, God, maybe 12, 14 years ago. And it was the first time that my family went to a show that I did. My family never saw any plays that I did, nothing. Like, they just weren't like that. They weren't brought up like that. They went to see a stand-up show, and there were people in the audience. It was packed. It was full. And my brothers looked at each other, and they're like, they're here for you? Like, they couldn't understand it. Like, they could not understand. They're like, wait, so you're going to go there? Like, this is what you're doing? And I'm like, yeah, you know, it's like, it's such a rare thing. My sister, I think, loved that I talked about her. In my new hour, I talk about my brothers, you know? Yeah. And I come from a very old-fashioned family. If my family told me that they didn't feel comfortable with what I was saying, I would never mention them ever again, because I was raised to always respect my family and how they are, what they wish. And they kind of like it, to the point now that I just started selling merch a year ago because my brothers wanted to sell merch for me. And they sell merch after the shows. Like, I'll fly them in. My brothers are teachers. One's retired. The other one still teaches high school in South Texas, where we grew up. And I fly them in on the weekends, and they sell the merch, and they go back because they just like being around the shows. I tell everybody, I'm building my own Selena y los Dinos. Like,
Be careful. Do you ever worry about stereotyping?
No, I never think about that, because I always say that I will not do anything that I cannot defend. Mm-hmm. To me, it's just like, I cannot tell you how to take what I do, but the people that get it, my God, they get it.
Oh yeah.
And it's like one of those things where you realize, you know, I think that also in the day and age that we live in, everyone will have an opinion. And we've been taught that everybody's opinion, they all think that their opinion matters, you know? And years ago, there was a fantastic show called Iconoclasts on the Sundance Channel. And they would get two influential people to talk to each other, have a conversation for an hour. And I saw an episode of Maya Angelou and Dave Chappelle. This is like maybe 20 years ago. And Dave is talking to Maya Angelou, and I still have it on my iTunes account. Like, I bought the episode and I still watch it. And she tells this part about how she doesn't hear feedback, whether it's good or bad. You know, it's just, she does what she does, and she just doesn't hear it. And she kind of phrases it in the way of like saying, don't pick it up, don't put it down. And it's just like, whatever people think, that's what they think. And it's funny, because I'll tell you, my best friend, Steve.
She's so wonderful like that too.
She is. And when you say it, you know, because, you know, she brings up this point that it's like, when people want to criticize you, look at who's criticizing you. Mm-hmm. You know, if there's one critic that doesn't like you, maybe they're not fans of your style of work that you're presenting. Doesn't mean that you're not good. Just means that it's not their cup of tea, you know? So it's this thing where I don't Google myself when I'm on social media. I'll post something. I might see a couple comments and stuff, but I never look at them, because to me, it's just, you know, I don't know what it is, but with stand-up comics, they will love to tell you ideas, like opinions, what they think of you. You know, but they don't go to Aerosmith and say, hey, Aerosmith, what's up with that?
Yeah, do you think your guitar? Right.
You know, so it's one of those things where, to me, I've never worried about how people perceive what I do, because I can always explain why I did it. And I think that comes from knowing the subject, which is my life. You know, it's like, I always
say, yes.
You know, it's like,
you know, when it's, you're not going to do anything that's hurtful. You would never never do it. You know?
And I think people don't understand. And, you know, it's like people that might not understand it. And, you know, it's weird because people don't understand how much I love the Latino community.
Oh, it shows. Your love comes through. It really does.
I hold it in high regards. I am so proud of who I am, everything that I am. And I love the Latino community because I grew up in it in such an extreme way, because living in a predominantly Mexican, you know, neighborhood, it's like, that's all you know. And it's like, for me, you just want to have those moments where you tell people when they don't get it. You just like, I wish there was a part of me that said, my God, I wish you knew how much I loved you.
Yeah.
I just wish you knew how much I loved you and how hard it is sometimes to convey something that you might not understand. And I always, you know, I love TV, right? I grew up watching TV. I hold it in high regard. I always say TV is my best friend. You know, it raised me. I think that TV can be wonderful when it's done well, you know, and people don't understand. I respect TV so much that people ask me, when are you doing another show? And I'm like, until I know that I can do a show that was good enough as my first show.
Mm-hmm.
I refuse to just come up with an idea.
Yeah,
because the audience knows when you mean it. The audience knows when you're really into it. And I refuse to give them anything that isn't what I do, you know? Yeah. And it's because of what I was saying. Everybody wants to feel represented. Everybody wants to feel like they're part of TV. But that's because we don't have enough representation, because, you know, people can be critical of the mom character in my show and they can say, well, she's stereotypical. But you can see like the old Roseanne show and you can see the Golden Girls and you're not like, oh, well, white women aren't like that. You know, you're allowed to just be personalities.
Yeah. Just going, this is a little bit different, but I think people are also interested in or they think they see that you've become more, I don't know, more of an activist, but you're speaking more openly.
Mm-hmm.
I think your comedy has always been like that, you know. Mm-hmm. But I think now, not just in your stand-up, mm-hmm. you're taking, you know, you're willing to say things, take positions, not, you know, immigration, but other things as well, civil rights. What's been your journey with that? That, you know, because I know that a lot of personalities don't want to do that. You know, they worry about alienating people, blah, blah, blah.
You know, to me, it's all about honesty. It really is about like where I am. You know, I think that to me, it was really interesting when I had my show. I did a show in Bakersfield and I did a meet and greet after the show. And I see this little old woman walking by and I'm with my best friend, Steve. And I look at him and I'm like, I think that's Dolores Huerta. And then I'm like, hold on. Right. And I'm like, Dolores, right? Like we're old high school friends, right?
Yeah. Right.
She's around, and I'm like, oh my God, it's Dolores Huerta. I'm like, hold on. And I put a hold, like I'm like, I will be right back, right? And I go up to her and I'm like, it is so great to meet you. But we do all of that. And she said, my daughter brought me to see you, watch your show, you know? And it was just such a glimpse. They didn't teach me who Dolores Huerta was at school.
Right.
I was such a nerd and I loved history so much that I would read and study in the summer. I would go to libraries and study and read because I just wanted to know more about my people, because I knew that they weren't teaching me. That's how I knew who Dolores was, you know? Month later, I end up going to the White House
mm-hmm.
and we're talking DACA and we're doing like an event with like Latinos and I see Dolores. And she tells me, we have this really beautiful moment where we're talking and she says that the name Cristela is very special to her. She has a connection with the name. And then after a while, she says, promise me that you will continue my work when I'm no longer here. At that moment, I said, absolutely, there will be no doubt that I will not, I will do that. And ever since that moment, I have really thrown myself into, she's really like my mentor when it comes to that. We've spent so many times, we've spent so many times just in minivans in the middle of nowhere going to like farms and talking to workers and having house meetings and, you know, spending time with someone like her. I remember we were in the minivan in the middle of Florida, like 10 years ago, 12 years ago. And it's really dark and we're on the road. And I ask her, Dolores, what do you think is one of the biggest lessons you've learned in life? And she said, you know what I love? I love when people realize that they are powerful. I love when I see that they have a power and I see them run with it. And it's because sometimes I have to tell them that they're powerful because no one's ever told them. And sometimes they need to hear that. And I remember when she said that, I started thinking, that is exactly what my stand-up tries to do.
Exactly. Yes.
You know, and it's like this thing where you just want to show people that you're a part of it too. Because a lot of times the Latino community does not feel like it's a part of something, even though they are.
I can't tell you how many people always to this day say, why are we invisible?
Yes.
There's this sense of invisibility.
You know, it's weird because growing up in a border town, it's like you kind of want to tell people what border town living is really like, right? And it's like this thing where they will talk about immigration, they will talk about border towns, but they won't talk about it to anybody that is an immigrant or at the border. You know, they'll bring in these experts and it's like experts with a blazer. And it's like, well, my book says, and it's like, I want to talk to the woman that's living in the border town. You know, I did an interview years ago where I explained how in my hometown area, I come from a little town called San Juan, which is next to McAllen, Texas. And I was telling them how the thing that we don't talk about when we talk about like the buying power of Latinos and, you know, it's like, I grew up in a border town where Mexicans come to this country, buy the cleaning supplies. They come shop here for, you know, like Tupperware, detergent, laundry, you know, like soap, because they like the quality here. Then at the end of the day, they go back to Mexico because they like the quality, but they live in Mexico. So they give us all of this buying power that, you know, they're just here. They pay the taxes, they go back. And the thing is that people don't realize immigrants don't want to leave their home if they don't have to.
I'm from San Diego, by the border. I know exactly what you're talking about.
And it's so weird because it's so
common. If they could be at home, they would live at home.
Yes. And why don't we talk about that? It's like, why don't we talk about the power? You know, I think the mall that's in my hometown area, La Plaza Mall, is like one of the biggest money-making malls in the country because of Mexico.
Everybody
who comes over. Yeah, you know, and it's just like, where is that? How are we invisible when we're everywhere?
Well, because it's what you're saying. Imagine you were the first person with a show, right? I was somewhere the other day and they gave us a book to read and we were supposed to, you know, it was a racial equity training. And then the book said, and you know, there were a lot of Latinos in this training. And they said, the prompt was, if you're white, answer these questions. If you're black, answer these questions.
Yes. Yes. Absolutely. Do you know how many times I'm kind of like,
I'm sorry, but it's a huge threat.
Absolutely. You know, and I think that's actually one of the reasons everything that we're talking about the feeling invisible, because I feel invisible. I was born here and I feel invisible. There are times where, like, when you're the first one or one of the first ones or one of the only ones in a room, what they don't tell you is how mentally exhausting it can be. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, and I always talked about the show. It's like, what people didn't understand was how hard it was to make that show, because the executives didn't know anything about Latino culture.
Yeah, I was wondering about that. Did you have to educate them or
what? Yes, but you're educating them while you're pitching stories. Right. So, you know, it's like this thing where, like, if they, you know, I had a pilot episode idea where my niece wanted to play soccer, but my sister didn't want to because she wanted her to be a cheerleader.
Yeah.
You know, and the executives are like, girls play soccer. And it's like, yeah, I know. And that's the problem, is that my sister doesn't want to let her play soccer, even though
girls play soccer.
You know, and they're like, no, but that doesn't seem real. No one's going to believe that because girls play soccer. And I'm like, what if the sister does not believe that? Because my sister didn't believe that, you know, and it's like this thing where I'm like, because in my, and then you have to go, because in my family structure, I grew up in an old fashioned Mexican family where
women have to explain everything.
Yeah. So you're just like, women were considered second to men. We always had to take care of the men first and then ourselves. So then da, 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 da. And I'm like, so blah, blah, blah. 5 minutes later, is that funny? Like, you know what I mean? Like, you know, because you're talking about the struggle. You're like, you get it now? Like, no, of course not. Of course not.
I'm amazed that you could do that. It really is. And I know, I think we have to go, but I have to tell you that I was really, when I was looking at, I don't know which of the routines, the one about you with the bag at Bloomingdale's.
Ah.
Because I'm very light skinned, as you can tell. This is not my real color. You know, you go gray, so then you go blonde. But but my mom was very dark skinned, very dark hair, and she had a very thick accent. And when we would go to the department stores, and she loved perfumes. She loved perfumes. And she, you know, and she would go and she could not, they would not even talk to her. They thought that she was not there to buy a perfume, and she would get so upset. And she knew her perfumes, actually. And she would say, I want to try that one, Joy, which is actually, at that time, was considered the most expensive perfume in the world, right. Joy.
Right.
But it was awful, you know,
yes.
Trying to get her taken seriously about, it was always awful, you know, you always know, awful.
The Bloomingdale's story came from a true place. And, you know, my friend Steve, we would go to the mall together, you know, Steve and I used to date. And when we dated many years ago, we would go to the stores, like we would go to the department stores, the expensive ones. And I would say, oh, I need to buy makeup, you know? And it got to the point where he would say, do you want me to go to the counter with you? And I'd say, no, let me see if they'll help me without you. And I would just stand there by the counter and nobody would help me. And he would be waiting for me. And I would give a hand signal and he'd come, and the women would come over and help me because they thought he was paying for my makeup. You know, it's like that kind of thing that in 2014, when I had my show, I had a network TV show. I went to a car dealership to buy a car. I wanted to test drive a car. I'm not into cars. I had already had an idea of what kind of car I wanted. Again, Steve and I go to the dealership in Beverly Hills. We want to test drive a car. And the guy doesn't want, he says, there's no cars for you to test drive. And at the time where I have a network TV show, I'm the star. I'm not only that, I'm starring on a network show and I'm hosting The View. And they thought that I would not buy the show. They didn't. They're like, she's not going to buy it. You're not going to test drive it. That was 10 years ago.
Yeah. So I know we have almost no time, so I want to say, just ask a couple of things. Hmm. So you talked about Dolores, you know, yes. and the activism. And I know we can't talk about endorsements yes. of candidates and all of that, but since this is the endowment and we do have,
absolutely.
What we do activism. What's on your mind right now in terms of the country and activism? And
you know what I want people to understand is that we have been taught to be cynical by people that don't want us to take action. We have been taught to feel that your vote doesn't matter. It's not true. It is people telling you that your vote doesn't matter. And people parrot the talking points because they've heard it long enough that they think it's true. Yeah. But the truth is that people wouldn't want to try to stop you from voting if your vote didn't matter. They wouldn't try to make it so hard if your vote didn't matter. And I think that really the cynicism is something that I want to focus on. Good. To me, it's not about like the party and this or that. It's the cynicism. We cannot make any change unless we change how we think ourselves, meaning that we have to start thinking, no politician is perfect. I've always said, everybody expects a 180 change anytime someone comes into the office. It's change is like losing weight. When you want to lose weight, you want to lose it quick. But you have to realize that it's going to take as long as it took for you to gain the weight, for you to lose it. And that's what change is. You vote for people and you try to do your best to make the change, but understand that the needle moves slowly. Sometimes it moves slowly. So what we have to do is celebrate when the needle moves a little bit, because that's another thing we don't do. We don't celebrate enough of the wins, because when we win, we start thinking, well, what next? What else can we win with? So we need to start simple, and we need to tell ourselves that change is possible. Change for the good, change for the better. My family taught me that. To me, the most important thing is to make sure that the majority of people have a chance to live a good life. And if that means that I have to pay more taxes, and if that means that I have to pay more of my share for it, I have no problem doing that. That because I was raised on food stamps. I went to Head Start. I used those programs that were available to me, and I want others to have that opportunity too. Why are we so selfish? If we can help each other, we can make a change.
That's wonderful. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. I feel like, you know, like I know you a little bit more than that backstage.
Yeah, I really do. You know, it's just, I love what I do. And sometimes I love it so much that it's so hard, but it's like the same thing that keeps me going every day.
Anything else you want to say before we sign off?
You know, really quick, the second special I did, I shot in Beverly Hills. And I always tell people, I've talked to people that went to that taping. And sometimes they'll ask me why I picked Beverly Hills. And I told them, it's because you need to know that we belong there.
Mm.
You know, and I want people to think there is no place where we don't belong. People always ask me, well, what do you want to do? What are you thinking about doing? What's next for you? And I'm like, I don't know. All I can tell you is that I want to be where you don't expect me to be. That's where I'll be. And that's where you can be too.
Thank you so much for talking to us tonight. And to our audience, thank you so much. I know you've all been chatting and you all want tickets to the show, and we'll put up a link. And thank you. This was beautiful. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Maria. It was my pleasure. Thank you so much.